Hello and welcome back again to our afternoon session of the special edition of Applied AI Conference on Semiconductors. AI and semiconductors, AI for semiconductors, semiconductors for AI, and everything connected to it. The two hottest technologies is what we are discussing today. My name is Matthias Grabner. I'm with Advantage Austria, and I'm with here
my
with
name my name is Clemens Wassner from AI Austria.
Today we are on separate locations, as this proves to be more feasible for today. And what we have planned for you next is an interesting panel discussion featuring some of the speakers you already saw in the morning session and some new ones. Clemens, what can we expect?
Yeah, in similar to the program that we had in the morning, we want to, on the one hand side, get a corporate view, then a startup view. But since this is also, or recently has become a topic of strategic importance, think of the semiconductor shortage, think of the trade war and so on, we also invited a representative from one of the most, let's say, famous and sprawling semiconductor ecosystems in Europe. It's from Silicon Saxony. So the panel will be co-moderated with Dietmar Millinger. Hi, Dietmar. He is one of the co-founders of AI Austria. And before that time, he already had a startup and plus exit in the embedded systems space. So and the two of us will run the panel. And yeah, we see you later, Matthias, in the Q&A round again.
Don't forget to use the opportunity to ask questions and interact here on the LinkedIn stream. See you a little bit later.
Great. So with us on the stage, we welcome the speakers from the morning, Mr. Andreas Siebrei. Hello, Mr. Hello. Siebrei.
Yeah.
Long time no see.
No.
Then we have from Infineon Technologies, but this time from the Austrian side and not from the analytics team in Munich, Mr. Staatsacher. Then from Silicon Saxony, Mr. Frank Bösenberg.
Hello, pleasure to be here.
Hello. And last but not least, Dr. Pedro Julian from Silicon Austria Labs.
Hello.
Hello. In terms of timekeeping, I would say we start with the introductions of those of the panelists that did not have a speech in the morning. So I would hand over the word briefly to Mr. Bösenberg that you tell us a little bit like who you are and equally important what Silicon Saxony is doing.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity. As shown here, my name is Frank. I'm the managing director of Silicon Saxony, microelectronics and ICT ecosystem, and with the same name association in the region of Saxony. You see it in the slide, probably. Again, as a reminder, where Saxony is, it's in the southeast of Germany, former eastern part or former GDR part. That's quite important also to understand our history. We are proud to count in total more than 70,000 employees in more than 2,500 companies in the areas of microelectronics and ICT in general. And in particular, the last weeks have brought some fantastic news, which good outreach beyond our region. With opening of the new Bosch fab and the settlement of the global research center of Vodafone and also a new site to be built by Jenoptik. I'm happy to contribute with our views here and looking forward to the discussion.
Thank you very much. I like the statement in the lower right corner because that's something you remember. Like every third ship in Europe is made in Saxony. It's good. Good trivia question for the next game. I would ask Mr. Siebrei for a brief self-introduction for those in the audience that had not the chance to join in the morning.
Okay, my name is Andreas Siebrei. I'm just a veteran on semiconductors, so more than 30 years I'm doing all kind of system design and semiconductors for various companies running various design centers. And I'm talking here for AI Storm. This is a startup based Silicon Valley. We are doing the central R&D here in Graz locally. And so I'm proud that we have a nice Austrian entity which is doing real AI. We are doing hardware AI, so we are not using AI hardware, just to put then applications around this. So we are developing charge domain AI engines inside of different technology nodes directly connected to the sensor. Thank you.
Thank you. Then next we have two panelists that will provide us a brief impulse talk. So I would first hand over the word to Mr. Starzacher for like 5 minutes overview plus slides, and then afterwards to Dr. Julian before we go into the discussion.
Okay, hello everybody. So my name is Andreas, as already known and provided the name. So what I'm discussing today is AI-based automation in semiconductor manufacturing. I'm responsible basically here in Villach, Austria, for digitalization topics, data science integration topics. So the interaction or the interface more or less to the FI, to the factory integration, to the IT guys, in order to have a complete picture to nicely integrate all the models that are being used in future and already. So let's dig into the short glance of who Infineon is. I guess those of you who were available in the morning, they already heard the same message, but we are on a top 10 semiconductor company and around 46,000 people, more than 46,000 people. And from this, roughly 4,500 in Austria, located in different locations. So currently we have 19 locations worldwide. And basically the most important news, it's been a long time ago already, but we are investing hugely in the so-called smart fab. Yeah, it's the chip factory, a 300 millimeter fab, where we are progressing and where we really invested on chip and automation level. Why? Because we think that semiconductor is really the link from the real to the digital world. So basically what you see here is that you have two sides of the coin. First, we as Infineon, as a semiconductor company, we use AI in our processes, but we also use or enable products to be AI-based. So what does this really mean? So basically we combine two worlds, the enabler role and the more or less we use it as our own. Especially in my case, we use this in a manufacturing shop floor level, maintenance, equipment, engineering, and that kind of stuff, where we want to include a high degree of automation merged with AI knowledge and technology. So here you see the product-centric AI versus, or it's not versus, complementing each other, the process-centric AI. So what you can see here is, it's sometimes overhyped, but nevertheless, we believe that AI really is the fastest technology shift. And it does not deal only with deploying some AI models, just having the model, the neural net or whatever, but it consists of really dealing with integration topics in an ecosystem of AI artifacts. So that's why we really want to see we identify mostly four smart factory parameters in order to gain operational excellence even further and to increase the time to market. And here you can see it's listed here. So it's first the integration part, which deals with AI processes and that kind of stuff, algorithms in the fab, but also in a global sense, supply chain topics and that kind of stuff. We also have the field of automation 4.0, which means just, we define it as automation plus AI to get more intelligence out of it. And of course, as a semiconductor industry, we produce huge amount of data And what to do with the data is up to the big data and analytics team, more or less, where we really want to get out the most of our data. Apart from the technology or technological aspects, we also focus on the digital working life, because this is a very important topic, and we also deal with responsibility concerning AI in the company. Towards, we really want to include AI where it's really bringing some benefit. So it doesn't make sense to, for example, set up a complete AI-based monitoring system or such things. So it really shall deal with things that really bring benefit, either on performance, on cost, and whatever. In order to consolidate this, this should then build up the smart factory strategy, where you have all the different kinds of levels of digitalization available. We maybe come later to this topic. And with this common scale, we are then providing to increase our support to our customers so that we can really increase time to market, as said, and operational excellence on shop floor level. Thanks. That was it. And I'm looking forward to the questions and hopeful good answers.
Great. Thank you very much. We will definitely dive into that later after our second and also last Impulse talk. So, Dr. Julian, I see you already share your slides. So let me put them on the stage. And yes, the mic is yours.
Okay. Thank you very much. My name is Pedro Julian. I'm the head of the research unit on embedded AI in Silicon Australabs. Silicon Australabs is a pretty young institution, which has a little bit over 2 years. It has three sites, one in Villach, one in campus, one in Graz, and one in Linz. The embedded systems division, where I belong to, has two places, the AI group in Linz and the edge computing and distributed software in Graz. And the group that I'm in charge of in Linz has basically three pillars. We have signal processing, machine learning, and integrated circuits. And we also collaborate and have a joint laboratory with JKU, the embedded signal processing and machine learning lab, where among other, we have four institutes from JKU. One of them, the Machine Learning Institute, directed by Sepp Hochheiter, who is the creator of LSTML neural networks. And I will give you a brief and quick introduction to what we are doing in AI related to semiconductors and silicon. So the use cases that we have for neuromorphic computation in silicon can be roughly divided in three: 2D arrays, mainly for smart imagers, where we try to do local computation at the pixel level with very few inputs, and we try to do very compact realizations. Then in another level, we want to do data accelerators like vector processors, where you now have like cache, a little bit more memory. You're not restricted to a 2D array now, so you can have a little bit more space and still focusing on low power. And last would be the level of deep neural network, where now you want to have a large number of neurons, each one with a large number of inputs. So to give you a little bit of an example of each one of those, this is one of the examples for the arrays. This is something we've done in the past. It was one of the first 3D imagers with processing. So every pixel here has a little bit of processing integrated in two different dyes. And then we also have structures to do computation at a higher level, like correlations and multipliers and dividers, and try to get information out of video. Then we progressed onto low power vector processors. And this is one of the examples of the units I was mentioning, where you have now cache memories. And this is a processor in 55 nanometers, which has roughly 4,000 neurons. And the power consumption for this would be 8 microwatts at half a volt. And then if you really want to do something large, like deep neural networks, well, then you have to go to a SoC, a system on chip structures. This one that you have here has a pretty large array of 49 different processors. Each processor has an internal structure with multiple cores that can communicate. There's a network on chip to communicate different processes and configure them in different ways to do your computation. This was a pretty big chip, 1.7 centimeters by 1.4 centimeters in 55 nanometer technologies. And so that's an idea of things that we have experienced. And the idea of SAL is to develop silicon IP for neural networks. And basically, we're thinking in doing that in two levels. First is low power neural network computation blocks for specific applications where we will have some particular structures, and then we could modify those according to the needs of the private sector, and also ancillary blocks, because you need a lot of wrapping around these systems to communicate, memory transfer, which sometimes is even more important than whatever you do to do a computation. And we planning to do this silicon proof. And one final comment, which is something interesting, where two groups of SAL have recently submitted a proposal to the Horizon Europe, which is a proposal to use AI to design computer chips. Not long ago, this came out of the news that Google could design entire chips in 6 hours during using some reinforcement learning techniques, and something which should not be underestimated, which is a lot of data to train this algorithm. So this is something very exciting that we are proposing to do in the future.
Great. So let me remove the slides so that we have a more discussion-friendly layout.
Okay. Clemens does the wordless handover. So let me start the discussion now with an impulse question. We have heard several very interesting aspects of AI for silicon and for in and in silicon and AI for silicon production. But I want to go a little bit into the geopolitical situation first and ask the question, what is the role of Europe as a huge area for 350 million people in the chip future? Because our hypothesis is, sure, AI and will be a new paradigm in silicon production, and but also for new technologies. So what do you think, and I want to ask Mr. Staatsacker and Mr. Bösenberg at this point, what do you think are our perspectives here? Or is the future still that most of the chips or many of the chips are produced in Asia, and we have to rely on political stability and other things in this area?
Maybe. So first of all, you need to have some sort of a balance, and of course, always check behind the balance of political issues, if there are any. But as far as we are concerned, so we are really investing hugely in Europe, as we believe that here, concerning transparency of the users, for the users, we really have gained a lot of trust. Yeah. And we also can offer very safe applications or safe chips in that sense. And this really shall differentiate us maybe also in the future from China, for example, US and the like.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I can only amend this. Basically, Europe has recognized the strategic importance of microelectronics, of semiconductors. So from our perspective, we are in a good way to keep our position as a partner on a global view, to keep competitive as Europe. And it's important really to highlight as Europe, not as Saxony, not as Germany, not as Austria, as Europe as a whole, because that's the level of play, Europe as a whole, not versus, but together with US and or China. Because this would allow us also to bring our views on the use of AI. Applying or the application of AI in the semiconductor production is one thing, and responsible AI in this environment is good, but whether it's extremely necessary or potentially dangerous, it's up to interpretation. But there are other fields of use of AI where I think it's important that Europe plays a shaping role in this, and to have a voice also in the production world is one, not the only, but one prerequisite of being a relevant voice on a global scale again.
Mm-hmm. And maybe to rephrase one of the questions, how much do you see a chance now in this new paradigm that we can re-enter the game? And because my hypothesis, I come from the automotive industry, is that a lot of the European chip portfolio is part of the automotive value chain, and contradict me if I'm wrong. This is my view from about 10 years ago, maybe. Is this still the case, or is there also a chance to build up new domains where chips can actually also be produced here in larger quantities?
That's a very, very strategic question. Basically, you know that there are discussions about having a really leading edge fab. I don't like the term leading edge, because what Infineon or Bosch or also NXP is doing is also leading edge. But we are having a discussion about a sub 10 nanometer fab in Europe, which is one approach to be a relevant player in AI, in production of AI ICs. I think as a strategic goal, it's important that Europe aims for having this. Mm-hmm. Not neglecting the industrial base that is existing and strengthening this. So, I sometimes make the comparison that as Europe, we are quite naked right now, and we are discussing whether to put the trousers on first or the shirt. We need both. If we look for 2030, an existing industrial base above 10 nanometer and something below, including a consistent value chain if it comes to the clients. So it would be, personally, I would be happy if we also would have relevant mobile phone producers from Europe again, computer producers again. And AI offers a field of economic activity where European players could arise that would also fill then respective European fab.
Mm-hmm. And this basically maps also with the recent study from McKinsey, where they propose or give a proposal what the yearly saving potentials would be in the semiconductor in general. So up to, if you count from today or from this year, 5 years later, we have a potential of 100 billion. So this means a lot. Of course, it depends how we react on the current trend, of the AI integration in order to be able to compete, mm-hmm. here.
And this means, this number means basically by optimizing the existing production lines or processes.
Exactly. What savings does AI enabled technology bring, mm-hmm. or would save in the future? Yeah. So currently the focus is on 5 to 8 billion it's predicted, and in 2 years it's 35 to 40 billions. In general, yeah, with a basis of 500 billion revenue overall, yeah. And this, of course, you need to slice down to your company and see where you can then have the major benefit out of it.
Mm-hmm. On the other side, the major trend of semiconductor foundries and also the location of semiconductor over the last 20 years was mainly built on power costs. And then strategic costs where you can get the people by. So there was always a trend that most of the stuff went to TSMC. So even European foundries, whatever we did in the last years, we used our old technology and the new technology and all of the investments nobody wants to spend, and it was moved out. So I think based on the pandemic right now, there is a general trend on local production. So, for example, TSMC built or they agreed right now to build big fabs in the US, which was never planned before, and also with the Infineon fab, with the Bosch fab, and hopefully some more are coming, and some other are building also up in this direction. We will balance this out again. But up to now, it was only a question of cost, and nearly no foundry was in the position or was thinking about to take this big investment in the hand in order to do this. So Bosch and Infineon, this is the first time I see this over years that this happens in Europe again. Mm-hmm. And I think also the European government is supporting this, because based on the pandemic, they try to have this type of technology inside of Europe, not to be so much dependent on China anymore.
Mm-hmm. And you mentioned one very interesting aspect, the cost of having, or the strategic cost of having people on site. This is one more questions. Would we have enough talent here in Europe, or for example in Saxony, to operate, for example, a major sub 10 nanometer fab, or how, what would we need to do to get those talent? Because especially when we are talking now about fully digitalized and AI optimized fabs, which are just another game. It's really a big step forward to have a highly integrated production value chain.
Well, if I'm looking right now for Saxony right now, look at the last 15 years. So we had AMD over there, then Infineon, Qimonda take this over. So I think in terms of people, there is enough knowledge at this place. Yeah, the big question always was, do we want to invest in this new technology, in the new machines, and then really spend for the money for this development? And there were just at the end of the day only 3-4 companies available of spending this money. Yeah? So even TI went out of this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I can only agree on this. Staff or qualified, skilled staff is not the limiting factor. It's still a cost-driven world. But what would help is if all costs would be taken into account, also opportunity costs. Huh? I mean, in the end, a local, and again, local in this context means European. A local production serving the local or domestic demand for really full cost consideration of this, you have to take into account geopolitical, geophysical, and all other risks that could appear just by supply chain being disrupted for whatever reason. And I mean, imagine now that production places of Volkswagen or BMW are being unused due to a tiny, tiny chip. So the costs are really considerably higher than if you take into consideration also costs that appear at the level of the user. of the products of microelectronics. And so it's a little bit a limited cost consideration. And I'm happy to see a kind of backwards trend, also to see the chance or the opportunities of having a local production, taking into account, in particular, previous developments. I mean, remember, Infineon was once a part of Siemens. Huh? It was outsourced as the risk was too high. The chances appear to be even higher, but you have to understand that it's really a strategic industry that for several reasons should be maintained in your own area of influence. And this is, I'm not even taking or talking about geopolitical risks, I'm just talking about geophysical risks. Think of the Ever Given in the Suez Channel and what this meant economically. Huh? So in the end, it's also a question of ecology, of a green development, of a more sustainable development of our entire world. If we go back to more, and I guess regional is the more correct phrase. There are more regional production than global production, which doesn't mean that I'm a fan of protectionism or disrupting global value chains.
Mm-hmm. There's just one small question which wasn't really answered up to now. Does anyone here in the panel think that that this paradigm change now into this digitalization of industries and the whole economy, does this will give us an opportunity now to step into the game as a new next step, or is this just tailored in the existing plans or strategies for silicon and technologies? So will this trigger us a new opportunity, or is it just same old game, but with new aspects? Does anybody of you have
a... I think basically it's a strategic aspect or a strategic shift there will be. Yeah. So not only from technology perspective, but also from people perspective. And if you take this into your company strategy as a fixed point, so for example, Infineon has this, is following, of course, want to support the mega trends. And here, for example, the digital transformation. Therefore, we have also, or we see potential business growth, for example, in the IoT and big data world. So that's why if you do not focus on this right now, also on strategic, on company level, it might get difficult. Then it would only be just to integrate it partially here and there.
Mm-hmm. So I can understand from what you're saying. So you don't see it as necessarily a completely new chance. It's just a new aspect of existing strategies and client base that you need to have. But because this is one thing I'm seeing very often. It's new startup companies with silicon ideas like AI Storm. But the challenge here I see is to really find the customer base. And we heard also today from the talk from Nico, they are looking for a new customer base. And so I'm also not completely convinced that AI and machine learning will bring us a ton of completely new opportunities. But I want to close up this round with another aspect, not only new business, but also new architectures. And there we have seen this RISC-V new architecture. And Mr. Julian, I just wanted to ask, how realistic do you see that such new models gain ground?
And which models can you say that again? It just broke up.
The RISC-V open source model. Like a completely, it's basically a new architecture that is proposed.
Well, I think from the area where I come from, you know, we are trying to modify things to get into extremely low power. So both in RISC and also a little bit in ARM, we've seen that there's space to tune that up and make dedicated architectures for really getting the edge for driving down the power requirements and make a difference with respect to if you're trying to push the envelope into the low power area. So I've seen that. I don't know if I specifically answer your question, but we are seeing progress there in sci-fi and ARM, and quite a fight they're getting between the two of them.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
There's also a system trade-off, and on your question, I think we talked about what new technology would help us or what could boost up Europe. You see, over the years, we did quite a good job here in Europe on providing new systems and new ways of putting things together itself. And I see AI as a big enabler. You see, on one side, we need the semiconductor locally available for this. But for the future, you see, right now they're coming with 2-nanometer technology out of this. And so this is going on. But on the other side, coming up with new materials, so going away from our standard way, this could be a very interesting step, what we can do here. And the second thing is, what can we integrate? Because right now, as long as we are staying with pure silicon, then we are quite limited. But there are so many R&D going on worldwide right now to mix this up. And then if we can mix this up, we can combine this and we can come to completely new frontiers, which nobody think about it's possible right now. So this is the technology part. Yeah. On the other side, if we really can make AI so low power that we can put this in the sensor, that we can drive this with a super small lithium battery for years, then tons of application will come up. And this gives us quite this will give a quite big industry, just to focus on this. Yeah. Right now we are talking about the next ARM and the big AI engines, but they are producing still watts of power. Yeah. On the other end, to prevent or to generate a sensor input or sensitive data, which we can use then for later on the big power AI. Yeah, I think this will enable us quite a lot in the future, and this will be a big market segment.
There's another thing to consider here, and is that when you take a look at the applications of IoT and all the places where you could put intelligence on a chip there, it's going to be a huge variety of different applications. I don't think it's going to be something where one player will dominate everything. If you come with the knowledge of a particular application, you will have opportunity and you have many different niche. And there's a couple of studies from Gartner looking that the majority of applications will be like this. So there will be plenty of room, and that pushes us towards the design. So and there's a huge opportunity there, because you will have many more opportunities. You could enable many more startups, but if you have to spend a year and a year and a half designing, and you have a machine learning algorithm that can do it in a day or two, well, I think there's a gap that you want to cover. You don't want to be left behind in Europe if you're doing design the old-fashioned way, when the world is speeding really fast into putting that into design and cutting the times extremely short. So that's something to pay a lot of attention.
I just want to make a comment on this design cut. This is not 100% gold, this talk, because to get a little bit in detail about the design cut. So what Google is talking and what really makes the design much faster is we are designing an accelerator by hand, really optimizing this very fast. Now we have a microcontroller, and I need to have these accelerators about 10,000 times inside in order to still to be controlled by this microcontroller or many. And what we are talking about and what Google is talking about, they came up with an algorithm, what we are calling digital backend. So using the digital backend tool, it could cause a very, very senior designer, it could cause weeks or months in order to find an optimal placement that he can connect these guys together. And here is what Google comes in with its AI. So they developed this algorithm really to optimize this. So instead of weeks and months, they could optimize this in hours. Yeah. And this engine, this could be used then for AI or for other big or super big system on chip designs, because on all of these places, you need to optimize then your placement in order to save power, die size, and cost.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I fully agree on those points,
right?
Yeah, and the more complex the design is, even though you have experienced designers, and we've seen that here in SAL in the RF area, sometimes it's very complicated to explore every possible alternative, and there are some things that you just go the standard way, the way people have done it for the last decades, and the solution might be somewhere else. If you pay attention to the algorithm that defeated in the Chinese play of Go, I think it was after 3 months, the artificial intelligence was producing plays that no one had ever seen before. And that's moving fast.
I think there are very good examples also from Airbus or similar companies, like those machine learning optimized systems, which have a clear mathematically described goal. They describe really surprising, almost bionic looking designs that are non-human, because we usually think in hierarchies and structures, while the system doesn't really care for let's say learned stuff. It just tests out things. So I think this is really a very interesting point, and we're in the middle of the next session with this. So we heard now two aspects of this. So it is a very important thing to look at, but also the field of application is still on very specific elements. I think the key is definitely that a lot of data is required for this, also a lot of compute. And I would like to hear the others also, what do you think about machine learning in the design process? So not optimizing the production as it is done with classical digitalization and machine learning solutions, but really let the system build optimal designs. And I fully agree to your remark, Mr. Siebrei. We will possibly very long have like very tiny technology cells being handmade, but then the combination of many, many of those cells might be one of the targets for optimization. And what are you thinking about this?
I have seen Cadence from day one until the last release, and it was always a talk where they promised us everything. We tried it out, and then we see more bugs than features. I was always supporting Cadence because all of the new release gives me new possibilities, to optimize circuitries, to have more checking capabilities and to speed up design. So at the end of the day, I think in the next years, we will get more and more advanced support for the design cycle. But at the end of the day, we always need our handful reference persons who could judge the outcome, mm-hmm. and who could also qualify this and really say, stop here, change the whole thing, do it new. So this is very important. You see, up to now, so when we do the standard design, so first time silicon goes directly in volume production, specifically for the cell phone market, yeah. So for one big SoC, we are using about 200 verification engineers, just pushing the cadence button always, letting the whole thing running, and doing all of the cycles in just to justify that we have then the match, or that we have a very, very high possibility, more than 90%, that this chip can go to production. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So to reduce this in the future, I think we have a huge potential, specifically with the AI, because on the AI, it's more than the placement and the non-regimetric things, which it's getting too complex for our brain. Yeah. But the basic decision and if it's going in the right direction and making, as I said, the basic decisions, I think the human cannot be replaced, but we can save a lot of power, manpower and time, yeah, by optimizing and using these tools.
Mm-hmm. And in addition to that, there's another thing that implies also an opportunity. Even though, you know, you may have the Cadence and Synopsys come up with tools, but in the end, when you're talking about machine learning, you can be as good as the data that you have. So if you're very good designing digital chips and I want to design an RF chip, that tool is going to do it for me. So there's a lot of small places where people can focus and really build custom things and knowledge, and that would be fundamental for a specific niche like IoT will demand. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I think that's a very nice statement, Clemens. I'm looking at the time.
At the clock here, yeah. It's like I'm the referee. Now I just noticed it's already 1:48. So before we come to the big closing statement rounds or the last question round, I would like to ask Mr. Bösenberg. I mean, first of all, thank you for tuning in and sharing the overview of Saxony. I must say, it's especially cool for me because I remember when I started to go to university, I was always reading this CT magazine, you know, from Heise, where they were talking about the new AMD plant and so on. And it's amazing to see what has grown out of this. So yeah, with that, do you have a closing statement or perhaps something also in the direction? What do you expect now on the one hand side, European AI Act, on the other hand, this public-private partnerships that the EU just announced 2 days ago, which should like foster the investment strategy?
Yeah, first of all, thanks again for the opportunity to speak here. I'm deeply sorry as I will have to leave in 2 minutes. My final statement is the one that I made in the beginning. It's a global race, and we can only compete in this race if we act together as Europe. And as a representative of one of the biggest semiconductor ecosystems in Europe, I insist on this message that it cannot be done by anyone in Europe alone, but it has to be a common European endeavor. And this goes on two levels. First is really the regional level, and we are already united in Silicon Europe, huh? Silicon Saxony, Silicon Alps, and other regions. But it also has to span across industries. So we need a closer cooperation between the users of semiconductors and the producers. To stay competitive in the global race, and to stay competitive is prerequisite to be able to represent also what we call the European values. Huh?
Thank you very much for this closing statement. Yeah, with this I release you to
Thank
your
you.
Next workshop.
Yeah.
After the call is before the call. Have a nice day.
Indeed. Thank you.
Bye. Bye. So Now that we have a majority of chip design people and let's say people with a research background on the panel, it would be interesting to poke a bit in the topic which other architectures are on the horizon when we talk about AI, machine learning, and chip architecture. So, I mean, quantum chips, of course, would be the obvious question, but I'm talking about the next 10 years. So, for example, how about photonics? Is this something where we see an uptake, or is this still a very, let's say, niche where only a couple of companies dig in?
I think you need to have a platform in order to go this way. So specifically for the photonics, you need to have like a semiconductor fab behind which could produce this. And then the question is, what can you integrate in order to combine this then with our standard silicon? Yeah. So the interconnect is always the question. And whatever we can do in standard silicon, for example, gallium arsenide was a big thing. We start with silicon germanium and all of this stuff, but nothing of this really took over or survived because the cheap stuff, which is the standard silicon integration, which could always be miniaturized, this was winning. Yeah. So when I'm looking forward right now in the next years, I think silicon will still be the major target. But we try to use then different engines. So I was talking about this charge domain engine. We could think about tons of different AI accelerators, which we are able to include into then a silicon engine which is microcontroller driven, yeah. So whatever comes up there, we can make this charge domain. We could make custom digital. A lot of people are working on this, yeah. On the other side, we try to apply new material because what is easy to add to a silicon process. Yeah. So what kind of process steps can we add in, still keeping the whole chain alive and gives us an advantage? And I think this type of questions will really boost us then to the next level.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree. There's still a long way to do in CMOS. But if you want to mention some architecture or some technology process that has it more than the potential, I would mention 3D stacking. And really, if you go to the, we are talking about AI. So let's talk about the brain. If you talk about the brain, you know, the factor that we have been missing still with respect to the brain is the 3D. So in the brain, you can go everywhere. And you have this massive density of neurons that you can wire because you have another dimension that in general we are lacking nowadays. So that if 3D stacking becomes really commercially viable as the same as 2D CMOS is today, that would be a huge boost and design architectures to build 3D.
Yeah, but so I agree. We are working on the 3D right now with the imagers. You see, we have the imager platform. Then we have a 40, 28 nanometer die-to-die package. Then IBM came up. I think they can add four or five different wafers they can put together. They are going in this direction. One of my key points is how can we handle memory? Yeah. Because specifically in AI, memory is our bottleneck. So whatever we are doing with memory, mm-hmm. with the architecture, because this gives us the architecture. So if we can place accessible local memory, and as you said, for example, stacking this then in the metal traces, so we have some sort of 3D with a very cheap technology, yeah? Then we can really do the next boost. Because if I have really very low dense memory available, then I can extend AI to whatever scale I want. Yeah, we have already a wafer AI. So on one wafer, we have about 15 to 40 different chips connected together. We are going in all of these ways. Yeah, but if we can overcome the memory hurdle, yeah, this will give us the biggest boost for the next years. Mm-hmm. Yeah, sorry, Andreas, I was...
No worry. So I fully agree with you. So basically, when we come from a top-down approach where we have our four main areas of applications, potentials, so for example, as I mentioned, the mobility, IoT, and that kind of stuff, security topics, then you come from an application requirements engineering perspective and see what are the trends, what is needed, what could be needed in the near future, and then try to find a solution on which technology to use, and basically then at the bottom, which material at the end. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Good. With regard to the time, I see that our next speaker is already in the pipeline. May I ask you for a closing statement from each of you? Could be rather where the industry is going, what you expect to see in terms of collaboration or funding, or also, let's say, regulatory boundary conditions. It's totally up to you.
Okay.
So if we go clockwise and start at the noon position, Mr. Staatsacher.
Yeah. So from my perspective, collaboration is a must. Yeah. Based on which regional, over regional, above regional area, whatever. And so for a closing statement, I would really go with the Infineon slogan and modify it a bit. So I would say, as with Infineon, AI will also be part of your life, my life, and also be part of the future.
Great. Then, next one, Dr. Julian.
Yeah, well, from my side, I'm from the side of SAL. We are putting together the capabilities in machine learning and integrated circuit design to help on this ecosystem. So, you know, let's play.
From my side as a startup, my view is the following. So I think it's very important to have startups, because big companies, they have to buy startups, or they have to get something in because they have a fixed procedure. And to come up with something new, they need startups. So a collaboration here is very welcomed. And the other point is, there is quite a lot of industries available which needs then really solutions. Yeah, right now there are a lot of solutions nobody will even think about, because everybody say it's not possible. But just to enable this type of solutions on a cooperation with new ideas coming from the startups, working on one side together with the industry who are selling this application, and on the other side, to the major foundry player, to get the local European support. I think this would be a big winning solution.
Perfect, excellent. Yeah, thank you very much. The same comment that I also had regarding the previous speakers. If there is any information you would like to share afterwards, like. Andreas, for example, received the question regarding the study where he provided the link. If there's anything you would like to share with the audience afterwards, just send us the links and we will post them also in the mailings that go out after the conference. So with this, we would like to close the session. Thanks a lot for showing up in such a big number and the insights. And yeah, as always, I'm looking forward to do something again in the future, perhaps even for an offline event. Let's see, fingers crossed. So
thank you also from my side.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye.
See you.
It was a pleasure. Bye-bye.
See you.
Ciao. Ciao.
So, and now here with me is Matthias again. Yeah, we will make a very short break before we start with the next speaker, which is also from the Silicon Saxony area, Mr. Klingstedt.
Exactly. There he is.
So, there he is, yeah. But here is static. The dynamic Mr. Klingstedt you will see in 2 minutes. So, see you soon.
See you in a minute. All right, and we are back for our next session of today, for which we go again to the east of Germany, to Saxony, which we already heard before is actually the heart of microelectronics of Europe with amazing companies. And with us here is Hans Klingstedt. He's Senior Project Manager for Business Development and Co-Creation at the Smart Systems Hub, which is one of the, I think, 12 hubs of excellence of the German Ministry of Economy and Energy. Please correct me if I'm wrong. Hello, Hans Klingstedt, can you hear us? Can we hear you?
Yeah, I hope so. So I can hear you well?
We can hear you as well. And wonderful.
Perfect. Thanks for having me. And hello to the audience as well.
Yes, and just again for housekeeping, this is all live. Clemens and I come to you from Vienna, and Hans Klingstedt from Dresden. Please use the opportunity to ask questions and interact in our LinkedIn live stream. You find the chat window right on the left side, right side of the video. And I see you already have shared your slides. Let me just quickly pull them up. Yeah, I'd Great. Say, Hans Klingstedt, the stage is yours.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Grabner, and thank you, Mr. Wagner, for the whole organization, and again, welcome to the audience. So I hope you had a good short break after this insightful and interesting discussion I was following too, and in the panel before. So some main outcomes, it was interesting to follow them. It's the answer summary, that the key findings are cooperation, then the approach, let's play, let's get to the play, and also go the first steps in cooperation with the other partners. And some of these topics I will now take on and to deepen it a little bit. So coming from this approach, from this findings. And on the other hand, we following the panel, we heard also some global connections and also some next steps, some developments. Mr. Bösenberg, for example, explained, or Mr. Staatsacher, and going into a company now or in the production area, they are actually under the enormous pressure on the fabs. You have to have the production designed as efficient as possible, right? And then on the current situation, you have to do the most of your capacity. And the capacity is a huge topic to gain as much as possible virtual capacity. And how can you do it? Via approaches of predictive maintenance, like to optimize the maintenance cycles as best as you can. And therefore, I was asked to bring or present a case study or a good use case from a project we conducted last year. It's a so-called digital product factory, so one of our innovation formats, which we do together with other partners. So it's one of the findings from the panel, to cooperate in some fields. And yeah, we did it with the help of AI to find these optimizations in the field of smart maintenance in a semiconductor manufacturing area. So that's the entry. And now I dive into the topic. It's also, I also like this citation because it emphasizes that it's not only about current share of the market and its technologies, but also about the speed in finding new ways of solving problems. Yeah, and in our project here, we tackled an industry problem in the semiconductor environment. And yeah, you in the audience now, I'm not sure how many people are participating right now, but perhaps you are an AI expert and you are interested in approaches and technological insights, or you are possibly a decision maker and you want to know what is possible for your machinery and your processes, or perhaps you are also a researcher and engineer and you look for new technologies or issues to leverage new use cases. And so with this kind of researchers, I hope that I don't bore you too much. And yeah, but what is it, or why we are here, or what of all of us have in common is our eagerness to discuss some AI problems and approaches, and where AI can help us to improve processes or products. And now I try to give you an overview and share some principles of the work we've done, and choosing the right approach and what it can lead to. And as already described, in Dresden, we are somehow also in the heart of microelectronics in Europe. But I would like to emphasize that we see it as a Silicon Europe more. So I don't want to make a big thing out of it now to say it's all located in Saxony. No, we try to connect. That's also why I'm here today, to get closer to Silicon Austria and this great whole discussion panel here and the event. And at the top of the slide you see some hard facts about our location, and we combine this expertise as a smart systems hub. We combine different competences in these key areas of hardware, software, and connectivity. But because it's not only about the big semiconductor manufacturers, it's about the ecosystem of software and connectivity related companies. And this is also clearly demonstrated by our shareholders and key partners who provide us the kind of necessary access also to research startups, software as well as hardware. So we've listed here a selection of some also startups with which have emerged from the network, and you will get to know also one today. So through this network, we create applicable IoT system solutions, not only from a single source, but of all sizes. And through these partners, we gain expertise with other companies in 5G, 6G, and different sensor technologies or cloud technologies, but also here, edge AI. Yeah. So what is this all about? It was about a challenge from a semiconductor manufacturer, the Global Foundries. It's a foundries also located in Dresden. And they had a challenge about their ultra pure clean water cycle. So it's a water cycle for ultra pure clean water, difficult word. And there, in this process, there are some components which have some difficult maintenance cycles. And therefore, we try to get, we try to solve a challenge there of valves. So this kind of valves, it's not the small valves you know from your home, but these are industry valves, like huge components. And we try to optimize this maintenance cycles for these components. And therefore, we got in touch with some partners, not only Global Foundries as a challenge owner, but also with a startup called Codritter, Infineon, then the startup Sensory, who delivered a multi-sensor platform for this, and T-Systems for cloud solutions. And therefore, we designed a team. We prepared the whole challenge. And to give you an insight, because I don't want to talk only, I would like to share a video. And therefore, I kindly ask one of the hosts to share the video I've loaded up here. Yeah, now it was coming.
Global Foundries is one of the biggest silicon foundries in the world, and its biggest European semiconductor facility is located in Dresden, Germany. Global Foundries offers a broad variety of semiconductor technologies, with nodes from 55 to 22 nanometer. Producing in high volume means excellent repeatability and high quality. This implies a continuous monitoring of materials and tools involved in the manufacturing process. One of the possible solutions here is to apply methods of artificial intelligence to improve the monitoring accuracy. As part of the Digital Product Factory, a three-month co-innovation sprint orchestrated by the Dresden Smart Systems Hub, a dedicated team from Global Foundries, together with partners from Infineon, Codritter, Sensory, and T-Systems MMS, took the challenge to solve a very specific monitoring problem in our facility. In addition to clean rooms, chip production also requires the use of ultra-pure water. At critical points, the control valves for ultra-pure water supply are to be monitored more closely. Detecting
I think it's the same technical glitch we had in the morning with the video of Mr. Siebrei. We will also have to send out this one afterwards. See, this is to the audience, if you ever wondered why you need edge computing, this is the reason. The cloud is failing us.
Okay.
Let me hand over the word to you so that you can continue with your talk.
Okay, Mr. Wasser. So it's no chance to start from the from this point again? No.
Sorry, you mean with the video?
Yeah, from this point there to reload? No.
No, it's I mean, I would assume it has to do with the backend, with the tool StreamYard we're using.
Okay.
Because this is now the sixth or seventh event we are running, and today not a single video we upload works. So, and since it's decentralized, Matthias has the problem in his office, I have the problem in my office, other participants have the problem in Germany and so on. This is a tool-specific problem.
Okay, so, yeah. Okay, don't worry. So I go on. Nevertheless, you got some impressions, unfortunately not from the environment where the like our solution is then attached, but you can watch it on YouTube as well. We will provide the link. And I will go on. You see my slides. Here you see the box, what we are talking about. And in this box, there's our solution. So, but now, again, about how to get to such a minimum viable product in 3 months. It means a minimum viable product means to prove the key assumptions and tasks which the challenge owner need to solve in order to have a basis for a rollout for such a tool, right? And currently in this huge diversity of technologies, there are integration issues, there are shop floor dependencies, like for already installed solutions, and there are also strategic plans of the company seeking for highly flexible solutions to understand patterns and also other implementation scenarios, and therefore this kind of first impression and first MVP there that helps them to find the right solution. And to solve such a task, we had to integrate the right persons at the right time with the right setting. And unfortunately, during the pandemic times, it's not in a room, it's in a virtual working environment. But so you have to focus in these 3 months step by step. And we do it in a guided process. And therefore, we have a methodology where we lead the team through such a process and where we enable the team members to work together efficiently. And one part is the methodology, but the other part is the know-how, the technological know-how and the IoT layers, and how to combine these IoT layers effectively. And in our project, we are always surprised which enormous talents we see in this project teams, also young AI talents. And it's great how far we get. Here you see the scenario. That's good that I included this slide if we can't see the video of the location there. At the end, we build up an IoT solution, which is application independent and which prevents at the end the downtimes in production through the AI-based early fall detection. And due to the fact that some of you are deeply involved in some IoT layers, so I told you we addressed the whole IoT stack. And before going deeper in the solution itself, I will give you a short overview here. So first thing to consider was choosing the right sensors to solve the challenge in combination with the sensor platform Ganymede. That's a solution coming from the Fraunhofer research project and then the startup Sensri. And as well as then the Infineon MEMS microphone from the Infineon MEMS microphone, who delivers a wide frequency range, why it was suitable in our case. And after collecting the data of bad and good walls, we choose an AI model and had to run it on Edge. But also to the cloud to improve it then on Edge. But I will tell you later more. The connectivity level was normal Wi-Fi. And in the IoT level, to administrate all device resources, we went for the Azure IoT Hub. Also in other project, we had some good progress there in a short time. And on the AI level in the cloud, we implemented also the AI model, and the top layer we see here is a user interface level, because it was also important in this use case to give the facility managers also a solution with a dashboard. Yeah, and here you see some key characteristics of the solution components. On one hand, I told you it's a multi-sensor platform where we attach the microphone. It has a certain characteristic. This Ganymede platform is also it can have different layouts, but a key characteristic is a RISC-V processor, and it's quite powerful for this size, also suitable for AI applications. Then we have the Infineon microphone from the Xensive application from Infineon. And there, what is the key characteristic is that it has a wide range of recording acoustic signals, so it has a good flexibility in different use cases. And that was one key issue why we went for this Infineon, and also it made sense because Infineon is also one of our key partners, so that was a great choice. And then we for the cloud environment, we went for the T-System Cloud Shopflow Intelligence to build up the cloud environments and the dashboards. You can see them here on the bottom. Yeah, and what about the solution itself? I told you about the Fraunhofer research project, and it's called Universal Sensor Platform, USEP. And we got one of these evaluation boards. So it was at this point not available for the market. Now you can buy these boards, and then they can configure it easily for your use case. And at the end, it's only has only a size of your nail, of your thumbnail. So it will be very, very smart and small. And here you see the Ganymede in this status, how it was. It has also WLAN module, and then we attached also the microphone. And what are the components? So this was also the biggest innovation step in the project, that we were able not only to connect microphone to record sensor data, of course, it was not a big deal, but we were able to program the Ganymede to process the sensor data and also to transfer the signals to the cloud to output unprocessed sensor data. And yeah, the key thing was to run an AI model on this so-called smart sensor. And therefore, this was the goal, this AI sensor. Here you can see the size in comparison, how it is in the end of the product, or it's the final Ganymede product. So we built up a model with the use of TensorFlow. It was at the end, we went for a model called AutoEncoder, because you have to imagine there are a lot of wolves in the shop floor running fine, and they have certain characteristics with which might be an indication with this kind of characteristic might, or this kind of sounds at the end, which might be give an indication that something is wrong with the wolf. And the one of the interesting thing is that these components, they most of the times they die slowly, so some differences in the sound, they can give you indications that you have to look for them, right? And not an engineer or a maintenance specialist is not all the time at the place to be. So when does it happen that the wolf goes down? When the engineer is next to the component itself, it's rare. That's why the whole use case was so interesting. Then was the issue to get the AI model run on the small device. So we had to translate it in another smaller model. It was at the end Connexor. And then we implemented this with the help of CodeRitter, and they were able to run it then on the Edge hardware. And what does it mean now? Edge computing, a lot of people talking about this. It's somehow a natural thing to try to do the most of the work on the edge level to get to the where the source of the information is located, that you go close to this point. So what does it help you? So it means that you don't have to send all data to the cloud. If I'm right, or if I remember right, in 2 weeks, like recording data from two walls in 2 weeks, it was more than 32 gigabyte of data. So imagine this with all walls in a production area, send this raw data to the cloud. So that will be not only costly, but also slow and not efficient at all. So that's important then to pre-process the data and then to run the model, the AI model on Edge to get a small data footprint. Then the other thing was to be flexible, to build a solution where also other customers, other production sites can plug and play with the solution. And also the reduced cost aspect of the cloud is remarkable. And also the integration, so easy integration that with the cloud, with the T-Systems cloud is one option, but you can also implement the solution without any dashboards to deliver. So you can use the data also in your own environment. And of course, it's also scalable because the hardware and the package you can use also for other components. You just then have to train for other components, the model, the acoustic model for this. And at the end, the challenge owner, it was here Dr. Axel Preuße. It was also interesting from his point because coming from experienced guys with simulation. Simulation is one option to prove your hypothesis, right? Another way is to build up a demonstrator. And for him, it was also a key finding. What about the future now? With the whole use case, you saw now different layers, right? I spoke about the hardware itself. There are some much more experienced know-how or persons with much more know-how in the audience here regarding hardware. So, and with this hardware, with this edge hardware, there's the solution now, the universal sensor platform from Sensory called Ganymede. There are also AI models for predictive maintenance coming from the Fraunhofer, and there are also application scenarios which I showed you for the whole dashboard environment. And all these different steps can be addressed now from the CodeRitter startup, which also arises from this project. So that is one example how an ecosystem can work together and at the end can address different pains of customers, right? And we as a smart systems hub, we are somehow the enabler with this innovation projects to bring different technologies together, like here the hardware from Sensory, then the software power from CodeRitter and T-Systems, and our power for the innovation project, and then the hardware expertise from Infineon, of course, for the microphone, and all together they're rising good topics. And at the end it will be a product now. There are next discussions for the industrialization, and also other partners are welcome to join this development and joint cooperation project, right? So we are now in the rollout with Global Foundries together. And it's also an invitation for all of you in the audience to join this cooperation, or also to join other innovation projects with us together. Because as we heard in the panel before, we have to work closely together in Europe for this kind of work and to bring out the most of our location here in Europe. Thank you. Now I look forward to some questions. And I hope Mr. Wasner can help me to coordinate a little bit.
This I can do. It's actually, yeah, thank you for the talk. It's actually funny that you mentioned the cooperation and the outreach, because this was exactly a comment that we have received. So let me show you. Yeah, this is like Silicon Alps, from the Alps to Saxony.
Yeah, great. So thank you, Ms. Mitrea. So I look forward for the contacting me.
I have actually one question, because yeah, what you have shown just now, going in the direction of predictive maintenance, or let's say industry 4.0 topics in the semiconductor industry, what are, in your experience, the specifics when doing I4.0 for the semiconductor industry? Do you need more certifications? Do you have a higher threshold when it comes to accuracy, failure proof, redundancy, and so on? Like for example, in banking, you need to have this high papers signed with regulations. If it's automotive, it's super security critical. And power envelope, if you think of edge deployment, so what would be the setting in semiconductors?
Yeah, so first of all, you have the benefit here for these solutions that everybody needs them in the production side, so in the on the production area. So it's not something which you or which the customers like Infineon or GlobalFoundries, which they integrate in their products, but they use it in their own production side. So they are more flexible regarding this. I think Mr. Staatsacher, he mentioned it also, that he's working on these two fields, like not only developing the products, but also to look for solutions for the own production area. And there, the semiconductors in Industry 4.0, if you mention it like this, I think they agree with me that 20 years ago, the semiconductor factories, they were on a Industry 4.0 level, like other markets. They are talking now about Industry 4.0, but like semiconductor manufacturing companies, they were still always in a very high level, and we heard about it like leading edge. So they set early on an early age high standards for Industry 4.0. So and now they try to optimize their production areas more and more. And there are some general approaches from controlling systems of, for example, Siemens. So if you have the general data of machines to control, like the specification of your products, that you always have the control of, that your outcome is aligned with the specification of your product. So that is one pillar. But the other pillar is now to set up your production as efficient as possible. And there are still downtimes that can occur, and there are still risks. And now on the current situation of capacities, of tense capacities, you have to try as much as you can to lower these risks. And they are looking now for solutions to integrate solutions, or also AI-based solutions, in their Industry 4.0, I call it, environment, and to lower these risks. And there, they are not interested in like building different, we call it Insellösung in German, so different solutions from different providers, but they want to control it by themselves. And there they are looking also for hardware software packages, which are easy to integrate in their own environment. And that is something this is kind of a flexible solution, what we delivered here, that they can do it, that they can integrate this flexible edge computing solution in their own environment. And this also this hardware is safe, as this kind of edge computing hardware is also is safer than, for example, if you host other clouds in your environment. And this is also was a key what made it successful, this project. So it is flexible and safe on the same time, so that it was easy to integrate. Yeah.
Great. Then Matthias, is the question from my side, because, you know, coming from the AI field, I could talk with you, Hans. I think we could talk until the evening because I have so many questions.
Yeah. we can meet later.
Yeah, I don't want to make it too nerdy.
Yeah.
So, Mr. Grabner, any famous last words?
Maybe you can repeat your invitation again to get in touch with you. I liked your comment that you also emphasize collaboration, and that you also don't consider yourself as representing Saxony, and that you are actually open for collaboration. Do you have a call to action for our community?
Yeah, I do have. We see that these kind of IoT AI-based solutions, they are quite complex, and we have different experts here from different fields of this IoT stack. So we have hardware specialists, we have probably also some software AI specialists here, and we have perhaps also people or manufacturing companies who are looking for easy integratable solutions. And there, yeah, you have to come together to cooperate and to explore in different use cases what could be the best solutions there coming together. And I think that was a good example how it could be. At the beginning, of course, there are different interests in the room and there are different expectations, but at the end, all saw what at the end it can lead to if people are working together in the right environment and bringing together different expertises. And that is something what I would like to see also in the future, that perhaps we can perform or conduct a project together with also members of the Silicon Alps and with other companies from Austria to come together and to join our competencies. That would be great, because somewhere you can start. For example, it was in our project, it was a topic that just an easy example. We had a problem that we weren't able to run the light TensorFlow on the edge processor there, and that was a topic which we can't solve, and we had to find the right model to implement on the edge hardware. So, and there to find the right approach, it was not easy. We even considered to run statistical methods instead of an deep learning model, and that was something where you can have an exchange about, right? So there's nothing what you have to hide for other partners. So that is something you can have an exchange about. So that was just an example from the AI view, and that's why I invite everybody to cooperate here and just text us, and we will be happy to either find a partner for your problem or to help you in a project, or that you join another project. That would be great.
Mm-hmm. That we end that on a great note, and let me just quickly display that slide again. And also, of course, I think your contact details, contact at smartsystemshub-.de. Yeah, thank you so much. Hope we can sometime come together in person, in the physical world. Thank you for taking the time and for sharing your projects, your experience with us and our community.
Yeah, thanks for having me, and I wish you a good event and a good afternoon.
Yeah, thank you.
Bye-bye.
All
thank
the best
you.
And see you next time. Bye.
See you.
Bye. Right, Clemens, our next speaker,
yeah,
as the name suggests, is from a company that makes machines C. And
I was coming to the time because here it's saying 3 p.m. But since we finished the panel much earlier than expected, and Mr. Traxler is already on the line, we would maybe make a 1 minute break, or let's say 2 minutes, so we can fetch a new coffee, and then we start in 2 minutes with Mr. Traxler and I.
And yeah, we are live right now, but if you join at 3 p.m., you can actually go back 15 minutes in case you missed anything. And all our sessions will stay online for you to rewatch. So see you in a bit. And thank you for being a part of AAIC in semiconductors.
So, and we're back.
Hello,
again,
we're back.
For the last speech of today. It's Mr. Johannes Traxler. This is almost correct. Now it's correct. Mr. Johannes Traxler, the CEO and founder of ICE. So let me add Johannes to the stream. Hello, Johannes.
Hello.
Hello and good afternoon.
Good
actually,
afternoon.
ICE is a rather new name. You might not be familiar with it because the original name of the company was AVI Systems, and it was coincidentally also one of the first companies I met in Austria which do AI hardware, or let's say chip design, FPGAs, and so on. It was 3 years ago on an AI Austria meetup in Vienna, where for the first time you presented your patent together with your research partner and so on. I remember it's like the intelligent rearview mirror.
Right. And today I'm going to present what we did till this presentation three years ago, and what our technology platform is able to do now, and what we are offering for users and customers who want to build embedded on the edge applications with deep learning insight.
Excellent. So I already mentioned to you before, due to the technical problems with the cloud service, we no videos today, it's just slides. So as in the previous talks, we hand over the stage to you and then come back for the Q&A session. And as always, the invitation to the audience, if you have something to ask to Johannes, shoot the questions on LinkedIn.
So let me pull up your slide. And yes, it works. With this out of the way, I'd say the stage is yours. We see each other for the Q&A session.
Thank you very much. Yeah, as I already mentioned, I'm proud to present our new technology platform, And at the beginning, I want to ask you, who needs a GPU if he can have an LPU? So for sure, you are asking now yourself, what is an LPU? And that's why I'm stepping into the next slide to show you what the LPU means. At the beginning, let me say a few words about ICE. As Clemens Wasner already mentioned, we changed our name. We have been AVI Systems till 2020, and we switched to the name ICE because it more shows what we are doing. Our claim is we make machine C, so we are providing safe and artificial-based solutions for different kind of applications, different markets, and we are not ending on the, let's say, ECU end of the communication. We are also building our own sensor systems and complete solutions, if it makes sense. Where are we located? Our headquarters is in Krems in Austria, near Vienna, 60 kilometers in the west of Vienna. And we have two sites in Germany, one in Freital, near Dresden. In the former presentation, the name Silicon Saxony was already taken or explained several times. So we are with our site also in this area, and that's why there is our development center of embedded systems and electronics. And we have one site in Aachen where the AI specialists and machine learning experts are located. And here in Austria, we have, let's say, the core development and production plant. So let me start with the explanation of our deep learning technology and the evolution. At the beginning, of course, I'm sure everybody knows it, the amount of operations needed to calculate CNN, for example, on image data or other kind of data is very high, and that's why very efficient ways to calculate this amount of operations in a short time is needed. And this was the situation or the issue we were facing in 2016 when we started to investigate into that problem. We started with some research projects with different kind of partners. One of the beginning project, this was the project that we were presenting in Vienna 3 years ago, was our artificial intelligence rearview system research project. It was funded by the Austrian FFG, and we had a project partner, the Software Competence Center Hagenberg there, who were supporting us, especially regarding the object tracking and time series algorithm that we were investigating in this project. Then we had a project in Germany running. It was called RailEye 3.0, together with the Technical University in Dresden, where the, let's say, hardware platform was designed. Here you can see a picture of the first version of the board we developed together with them. And it was, let's say, a very early start, and we were facing the problem, oh, it's really difficult to get a deep learning application running on the edge. And to summarize the issues we are facing, I want to tell you that at the first point, we had the problem that we had to find a solution to minimize the dimension or the size of the neural network. Of course, it should be optimized in that way that the needed operations are as less as possible. Then we had to improve the training algorithm itself. We were facing the problem that in different applications, for example, in the rail market or also in automotive market, it was difficult to get a ground truth. If you are expecting millions of pictures and you have to annotate them manually, you can imagine that this is a very big effort, and therefore we were looking for solutions. How can we automate this? How can we optimize this training process? And then, of course, we are coming from the functional safety area. So we are in our projects always facing, let's say, safety issues. The system have to guarantee some core functions, some safety functions, and therefore we were looking for solutions to build explainability in our neural network approaches. And at the end, of course, we had to find a solution and hardware platform that enables us to bring this neural network intelligence into the vehicle, where we always have harsh environment with less energy available and different requirements regarding interfaces and everything else. So let me step into the challenge one. This was the challenge we were facing regarding quantization. Of course, we took the decision in 2016 that we do not think that it will be possible to equip systems in our project with GPUs. We were looking for a solution that brings us in the position to use parallel processing platforms with less power consumption. And therefore, we were looking for a solution to quantize the neural networks down to 4-bit, if possible, without losing a lot of information and reaching the same mean square error as the original neural network. And therefore, we were developing some very innovative approaches that we put into a patent in 2019. And of course, at the same time, we were facing the issue that if we find an inference platform, we will have to build an adaption stage and adaption tool chain that enables us to bring a pre-trained neural network into the inference platform. And both things together were one big development project in 2018, where we also started to bring our technology into real world systems and vehicles. And the outcome of this development project was our tool chain, group of tools that we can provide to our customers, starting with the training itself or using pre-trained neural networks and transfer learn techniques to minimize the outcome of this step using pruning and cutoff technologies, optimize the outcome of this network, of this step, simulated with the focus on the platform that is decided to deploy the neural network on the edge, and then an export tool to bring the result into our platform. And here there are some comparisons between our technology, and in this case we took TensorFlow Lite as an additional or comparable optimization library. And here you can see that the quantization loss is much lower using our technology compared with TensorFlow Lite, using this this special, let's say, techniques that we were developing in our tools. So we passed this first challenge we could offer a tool chain that is able to bring our neural networks or other neural networks into a very minimized dimension or size. The second step was decreasing of the calculation or operations itself. Of course, it's a little bit mixed with the challenge one. We're using, in addition or in front of the quantization step, pruning and cutting techniques. And here you can see the decreasing of parameters, for example, or other operations that are needed via the different layers. We could show that we can minimize the neural network keeping the same mean average precision values as it had in the original version. So we also passed this challenge too. Here you can see a comparison between a tiny YOLO V3 our solutions, and also the reduction using a specific batch norm optimization approaches. Yeah, of course, the important thing is to keep the performance as high as possible. And as I mentioned at the beginning, to make the system reliable, and therefore we were researching on explainability approaches, different kind of algorithm that enables us to get, in addition to the common confidence value, additional results that enables that bring us in the position to decide if the actual outcome of the neural network is reliable. And therefore, we were using, we called it real-time explainability approaches that brings us or gives us the results that we can decide if, for example, an object, as you can see here on the right lower part of the slide, if the center of the object, for example, is a possible center, if this could be a person or not, or if, for example, here in the upper part of the picture, there were some parts of the picture that also caused a higher response of for the neural network, and we can adjust or decide with a priori knowledge, for example, or other logical rules that this example or this result cannot be realistic or cannot be a true object. And using these techniques, we can increase the reliability of the result of the neural network. And at the moment, we are in a research project to bring this into our hardware platform and use this in real time in an realistic or real world use case. So, and the fourth challenge was to implement or to realize a parallel processing unit that enables us to realize an on the edge application with very low power consumption in an on vehicle use case. And when we started in 2016, there was no real platform existing that we could use and take in our project. So we started to develop our own processing unit. The outcome of this research and development project was the today called Layer Processing Unit. It's compared to an GPU, which is using vector operations, or a TPU, which is optimized for tensor operation, a specific processing unit that is optimized for processing a complete layer in one step. So there, it's not only different tensor operations in one step, but also addition or activation function comparisons, and this all can be done in a parallel way. So if you are putting data into this unit and you give it the correct parameters and you add a clock signal on the unit input, then you would directly get the result of the layout. And this means that it's a very optimized and high efficient processing unit that enables us or enabled us to build the first products out of it that we are already using now in the market. Yeah, this is just a very rough picture how it works. So you add the input data or you connect the input data into the first layer, step over it with one clock, and the results are then directly connected to the next layer. And again, you put it or you give one clock to the LPU, and then you get the result for the next layer. And so you step through the whole deep neural network until you get the result at the end. And the reason why it is so high efficient, as we already have heard in the former presentations, the big limitation is always the bandwidth through the to the storage or to the memory, and we were implementing or realizing a solution that is decreasing the needed bandwidth through the memory very much, and because we keep the data inside the LPU, and this caused this high efficient processing. Yeah, this is how it looks in the technical way. So here you can see on the convolution part, the batch norm layer, this, the activation sublayer, and optional pooling or other sublayers are stepped through with one clock. And this means that we are reaching several thousand operations in one clock. And if you imagine that we can provide at the moment on, let's say, 28 nanometer FPGA around 135 megahertz clock rate, then you can realize with this system already real-time applications with only 2 watt power consumption. This is how it looks like. At the moment, it's an IP core that you can integrate into an FPGA. And of course, we are looking for partners or customers who will enable us to bring the LPU into a real world ASIC, so that we can optimize the bandwidth through the memory and additional integration steps that we already have in mind, but we cannot do today on the FPGA in an specific chip that will be able to increase the efficiency and also decrease the needed power consumption. This is how the IP core is looking like today. So at the moment, we are able to provide different kind of kernel width and height, different kind of strides, padding, and so on. The important thing is that the LPU is a generalized processing unit, which means that it can be used for, let's say, in principle, any kind of network model. Of course, there are restrictions according to realized or implemented activation functions and kernel sizes and etc. But in principle, it's generic, and you can change the model during runtime. So you can also use it to run different kind of models in not the real same time, but in different clocks, and switch between these neural network models. So it's a very flexible platform, and in that kind, a very future safe technology. So if you are using an LPU in your system, you can always update or upgrade the system. And so we also managed the challenge for reached a very high efficient platform. So at the end, of course, now some few words about the safety topic. As I mentioned, are always working in a safety near area where we need some reliable results out of our systems. Therefore, we are integrated some first explainability approaches in a runtime environment. Of course, this is still a research area where we are at the moment working together with our partners to find final solutions to, let's say, integrate an additional percentage or confidence value into the result and get it running in a fully integrated application. And we think this will be the real big next step to get, for example, autonomous vehicle or robotics more reliable and realize more complex applications. So to summarize, our layer processing unit is a very powerful and efficient mobile and embedded parallel processing unit. It's extremely high processing performance combined with low costs, which is also, of course, very important at the end. It's open for any kind of neural networks model, and it is able to process in real time with a very low latency caused by parallel processing for any kind of real-time application or also low-power application that might come up for deep learning use cases. And to offer our customers a solution that they can integrate into their systems or into their applications, we we're facing the issue that we also have to provide some kind of platform, some kind of PCB that is easy to integrate and that can be used in many different applications. And therefore, we were developing our so-called real-time interface in the version 3 now. The first two versions are already used from us in our own products, for example, the real-time interface 2 is used in our turn assistant system, the worldwide first turn assistant, truck turn assistant system based on deep learning technology. And the real-time interface 3 is now a more flexible platform with pre-installed Linux operating system and with different kind of interfaces that make the platform very, we think, useful for different kind of applications. Here you can see a rough overview of the components and interfaces that the real-time interface is providing. We have on the one hand two FPT Link 3 serial interfaces where we can connect any kind of FPD link camera or sensors, and the interfaces are also used to integrate, for example, our own full HD sensor board. Then we have an own developed image signal processing core that is able to control and steer the different FPD link 3 devices. And we have an integrated encoding, which native provides H.264 and for special project also MPEG-2. An ARM processor, which is on chip, and the layer processing, of course, which is a pre-installed IP core that can be controlled out of the Linux operating system. And yeah, additional interfaces like UART and Ethernet, of course, to communicate with the device, and the gigabit transceiver to be compatible with our own baseboard that can be used to build up more powerful systems for an ECU, for example, to control different kind of vehicles or robots. And yeah, of course, we are offering, in addition to the electronics, also the software stack to enable our customer to bring their own pre-trained neural network on it, or you can use our pre-installed CNN called IceNet, which is able to detect up to 21 classes of objects, of course, specialized for automotive applications or automotive near applications. Any kind of object classes and object types are detected from this neural network. And you can combine this very flexible with our different IP cores as needed in your own use case. So how does it look like? This is a picture of our RTI 3. You can see here there is a Xilinx MPSoC on chip or on board. And there you can see the two FPD-Link 3 interfaces here with the FACROSET connector. And as I already told you, there is an Ethernet interface on board. You can connect via standard Ethernet through the operating system. And there is a web server inside that will or that is enabling you to configure the system to set, for example, IP addresses, etc., and to select the correct neural network you want to use. And yeah, everything else is, let's say, out of the box. So we have the possibility to show the features and the efficiency of our layer processing unit now on a hardware platform. Yeah, here the summarization of the different features again. Here you can see two examples of sensors or cameras we are offering two different kinds of housings that you can use in your project. They are already ruggedized, so they are, have an increased protection level of 67 and heating inside and so on. But therefore, you can go onto our homepage, www.ice.com, and there you can find more details about the different components. So to summarize the next steps, the RTI3 I showed you in the slides before will be available in autumn 2021. So at the moment we are in the prototype phase, and as a product it will be available in autumn. Pre-built use cases will be pre-installed, so it's ready to use as an let's say custom off-the-shelf product. Extended parameters and support mechanisms for different models will be provided. This is where we are in different research projects still working on, and it will be available in different applications with different cable sets and configurations. And you can increase the performance factor of up to 2 using event-driven approach, which will be the next release from our LPU. So we are working on additional improvements of the processing using, let's say, spiking neural networks approaches, and this will be also available till end of the year, and we always have the philosophy that we will provide or we will offer upgrades then for already existing LPU users, so it's a future safe platform. And here there is the outlook. As I already mentioned, we are starting with the RTI 3 in autumn, and we are working on additional neuromorphic approaches, and are planning to offer it as an additional product step in 2023. So, and now I would like to share the video with you. I hope this will work, to give you an idea what our existing IceNet is able to do. It seems to run. Okay, here we have a video from a test drive from the inner part of Vienna. And you can see on the different frames of the object, there is on the upper left side, on the one hand, the distance written. So we are using 2D 3D matching algorithms for that. And the confidence level of the object using a combination of, let's say, the standard confidence values and explainability approaches. And here you can see that the different object classes that we are providing at the moment. So, and to finalize the presentation, this is these are the markets where we are already inside, where we are offering existing products and solutions. So we are not only talking about this technique, we are really already in the market. In railway business, we are providing front collision assistant, blind spot information system, information systems already. SIL 1 certified rear view systems. And in the automotive market, our own product, our turn assistant system for trucks. And we are working on blind spot information system. We are part of projects for autonomous driving and prototype vehicles. And are offering intelligent rearview mirror and 330 degrees surround detection systems. All these solutions are based on our electronic platforms or electronic components, where the RTI 3 will be a very important next step. In the security market, applications like intrusion detection, people counting, bicycle driver detection, zone surveillance. In the traffic market, vehicle identification system, traffic analysis system, red light enforcement, till tunnel sensor fusion and parking systems. And in the manufacturing area, very specialized discontinuity detections on transparent painted parts or on intransparent painted parts. This is an additional AI area where we are working now for 3 years already. So I hope the presentation was interesting and gave you an overview about what we are doing. And to summarize or to give you our vision at the end of the presentation, we are providing explainable embedded AI solutions for a safer world. And I think this is a very good reason to work in this area, and gives us the right drive to go in the right direction. Thank you.
Thank you so much for your presentation. It's amazing to hear where your technologies are applied. And this was very, very insightful. We have maybe Clemens here on my side. I see one question. It's also going to the technical part a little bit, and we received it about 20 minutes ago. So, apart from TensorFlow Lite, did you ever try to compare to Apache TVM, which is used by most of the major chipset vendors?
Yeah, at the moment I have to say no. Yeah, we are working on this, but at the moment I cannot provide results. We know Apache TVM, and we are thinking that it might be comparable, but at the moment we do not know. Yeah.
Yeah, he also sent for a reference. Yeah. Right. Thank you very much, Remco.
Yeah. The point is, I think, of course, there will always be an improvement, especially for optimization tools, and it's very hard to always stay on the top. But our LPU itself, it's more or less an independent step of that. Of course, we are using our own tools now to build our own applications. But the real idea, or the major idea behind, is to promote the LPU as an additional platform, because we think, or our investigation showed us, that we really have a big advantage there. And at the end, Apache TVM could also be used, because at the end it's optimizing the neural network for a specific processing technique. And why not using an LPU there as one of these platforms? So it's not a competition, it's more an additional tool that we could also provide for our customers.
Make use of Cray. Great.
Yeah, then I would actually have a question, because as both you and me mentioned, when we met 3 years ago, you were really in the first innings of going in the direction of the LPU. I think back then the name didn't even exist, or let's say the abbreviation. How difficult is it, in your opinion, for a European startup to do this type of a pivot towards deep tech while at the same time still running customer projects? So you're basically solving two problems at the same time.
Yeah. This is always very difficult, of course, because we have to earn our own money at the end. Yeah. And this is really hard. Yeah. Of course, I have to say, using the public funding, this was a very important step. Otherwise, it would not be possible. But even with this money, we always are facing, of course, the issue where what we should prioritize more. Yeah. And because this area is developing so dynamically, you cannot stop researching for even 1 month there. Yeah? Otherwise, there is so much improvement already, and you are losing the target, or you are losing your position. This is hard for us, but I would say we managed it till now very well.
May I ask, how large is your team at the moment?
At the moment, we are a little bit above 30 people, and around 20 people are working in the R&D department. It's of course still a classical SME. We have now a long-term relationship with our experts, and at the end it's normally not a question of the quantity. Yeah? So it's always it is very important that the people who are working in this area have enough experience.
In terms of team size, this is a remarkably high number, because in Austria I mean, obviously in Austria, but still in startup land, you normally have much smaller teams operating. So you received quite a scale considering in which field you're in. It's not like you have 25 people doing BDE code calls all day long, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
That's quite an accomplishment.
That's a size where you can earn your own money and still stay on the top of developments.
It's possible. Yeah, of course, we have a lot of hats always on, so we are switching every day in many different roles. And of course, what is also very, let's say, difficult is that, for example, in the rail market or in the automotive market, even if we are such a small company, we have to fulfill all the standards and process requirements, like a company who is manufacturing millions of vehicles. So this is an additional issue we are facing here in Europe. But I would say we found a good approach to bring all together.
Excellent. Speaking of many hats to wear, maybe one final, that's not really a question, but like a statement. We always ask our participants for a call for action. You mentioned that you're looking for cooperation partners and clients. Mm-hmm. How about investors? Because on our previous event that just ended 3 weeks ago, we had a deep dive on investments, and there you had like Early Bird Ventures, Atomico, and so on. Are you also raising money at the moment?
Yes. Yeah, we are at the beginning. So we did one investment round in 2019, this year we are planning the next step. And we are at the moment in the preparation of it. Yeah. So in autumn, we will go on the market with the new investment documents.
Interesting. Yeah.
So we are looking for some new partners there.
Great. Yeah, as far as questions are concerned, we are through. Yeah, thanks a lot, Johannes. I think this was the first time we dealt with each other since then, because most of the time your colleagues are coming to our events. This time it was you again.
Right. It was a pleasure for me, and I enjoyed. I was listening the presentations till midday, so it was very interesting. Also the former presentations, I think it's a very good event and very interesting participants. Congratulations on that.
Thank you for being a part of it.
Thank you.
Yeah.
And so, with this, best wishes from here in Vienna.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Yep. Have a nice day and bye.
Goodbye. Goodbye.
All right, Clemens. This was an eventful day.
Yes, melting computers, server outages, clouds gone rogue. It had it all, but surprisingly, it still worked, and nobody knocked at the door and throwing tomatoes in the office. So that is good.
That also didn't happen. Yeah. Well, this is live, as I always say. But we also have some few more announcements for those who are still listening and watching. To stay in the loop and to be informed on what the future applied AI conferences we are preparing, and also for the calls to action from our speakers and participants, follow us on LinkedIn and on YouTube, where we continuously post new content. Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you.
We appreciate it. Thank you very much. AI in semiconductors was presented by AI Austria. Silicon Alps and by Advantage Austria. And we thank our partners and friends at Silicon Alps, at Silicon Saxony, of course at Infineon, and at Springer Professional. Clemens, you want to lose one or two words on your upcoming events on the AI Austria side?
Yeah, you, two or three is right. As far as the Applied AI Conference is concerned, we are now going into the summer break, so to speak. So the next event will take place on AI in the gaming industry in fall. So let's say September, October, November. It's not totally fixed, but lots of different angles how you can tackle or how you can apply AI in the gaming industry. Before that is a rather smaller event that is taking place in Tirol each year. It is organized together by AI Austria and the IACD Hermann Hauser, which is actually quite a good match to announce this at the semiconductor event. Hermann Hauser is one of the co-founders of ARM. And each year, once he's holding an event called State of AI. So this year, we will also have him on the stage. The event will be live streamed, and yeah, stay tuned for online announcements. And as far as the other three events are concerned, they are, let's say, from our organization partner of today, Silicon Alps. For updates on this type of events, you head over either to the Silicon Alps homepage or on their LinkedIn channel, which also is very frequently updated with content.
Right.
And now, Matthias, I expect 500 events from the Economic Chamber.
Well, we have too much planned, but of course, AI is a topic at all the big trade shows and trade missions that we are planning. Also at the Expo Pavilion of Austria at the Expo Dubai this year. But I want to highlight three things that could be interesting. Our SOFIA in Bulgaria office is organizing a business circle on June 22, next week. You can join in by registering online. We are in Barcelona at the IoT Solutions World Congress, which is a great upcoming event, so to say the second Mobile World Congress already. And which might be interesting, an Austria showcase on AI, cybersecurity, and critical infrastructure to Jordan. You can also get in touch with my colleague, Herwig Neuper at aman@advantageaustria.org. For all our friends in Jordan and in Austria, this could be interesting. Well, without further ado, Clemens, I would say we are through. It was a pleasure.
Accomplished.
And yeah, please get in touch if you have suggestions on what we could do and who we could connect on, how we could collaborate, because once again, we heard it's about connecting domain knowledge from different areas and thinking big, thinking international. So thank you for being a part of it. I want to play the video once again.
Ooh, this is the brave. That's very brave.
I don't know.
Before the internet explodes, if you do that, I also would like to say thank you.
Please.
Yeah, we posted the links like 50 times how you can get engaged with us via LinkedIn, via email and so on. And yeah, I would also like to rephrase what Matthias said. If you have ideas on different formats or different topics we could cover, like semiconductors, like logistics, which we had, or the upcoming gaming event, just contact us. As you can see, we are very flexible when it comes to forming partnerships, like now with Silicon Alps and Silicon Saxony, and form around the, let's say, core community and international event out of it. And best of all, it's free, of course, because we are non-profit. So yeah, happy to receive your ideas in the future. And now we try the video again. So thank you very much and have a nice summer.
Bye-bye.